Good morning. Blessed Sabbath. We want to welcome each of you here. We believe this is a very important Sabbath. We believe that this is the day the Lord hath made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. We are certainly thankful for it. I want to go right into my text today. It's in Revelation chapter 13. And we're going to read verses 1 through 3 and focus on verse 3 for a few minutes this morning. Revelation chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. John writes and he says, I stood upon the sand of the sea, and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion, and the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Verse 3, And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Now, we, I think, have a pretty good understanding of the identifying marks and the identity, actually, of this beast's power. And it's interesting, though, in verse 3 here, he says that the whole world and all the world, the Greek word is holos. We get our word holistic from, you know, like whole medicine, everything. All the world, it says, wondered after the beast or marveled. The Greek word means to marvel. It's used, for instance, in Matthew chapter 8, if we turn to Matthew 8, just to give you a little understanding of it. Matthew 8 and verse 27. Jesus was in a ship with some of the disciples, and a great storm had arose, and he rebuked the winds. And verse 27 says, But the men marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? If you can just your mind's eye picture being there in that boat, and just seemingly sure death is just moments away from you. And no one messes with the elements. But all of a sudden, the elements stand still and obey this man's voice. And they marveled. All the world marveled. All the world wondered after the beast's power. Now, this text seems to be all-inclusive, but the fact is that there are some who will not. In Revelation, if we go back to Revelation chapter 17, in verse 14, it says, These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. It's speaking of a group of 10 kings or 10 powers that confederate themselves with this beast's power. And it says they make war with the Lamb, and they do this by making war with the Lamb's people. But the Bible says that God is going to have some who are the called, the chosen, and they're the faithful. And that's who I want to be. And I want you to be part of that group too. There will be some who won't follow that beast. And that includes, friends, everyone who is faithful, but only those who are faithful. But you think about this world we live in today. There are over 1 billion Muslim people in the world today. There are over 1 billion Roman Catholic people in the world today. And there are almost a billion Protestants or professed Protestants. And yet all of these people are going to wonder after the beast's power. As well as the Hindus and the Buddhists and all those other groups, they're all going to wonder after the beast's power. And so here we are in what we call professed Christianity. We are in a little narrower sect of Christianity. We are in the lower half of professed Christianity because Catholicism is the majority of professed Christianity. Protestantism is slightly smaller. But then within Protestantism, then we come down into Adventism, and that narrows it down a little bit more. A lot more. And then to narrow down even a lot more, we come down into those people who are trying to stand by the old way marks, who aren't just going along with the crowd or the herd mentality, as it were. And they're going to be a different, unique kind of people in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. He says, But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should shew forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now here Peter says that this group of people, that they are chosen. Remember in Revelation 17 there was a group of people that are the called, the chosen, the faithful. But he also calls them here what kind of people? A peculiar people. These are people who are going to stick out, as it were, like a sore thumb. These are going to be people who don't fit in with the mold of the rest of the world. And these are going to be the people who will not wonder after the beast, who will not follow this beast power. Now, as you study in the book of Revelation chapter 13 particularly, and you read about this beast's power, the characteristics of this beast, a persecuting power, reigns for 42 months, several different identifying marks, we realize that it's the very same power that's depicted in Daniel chapter 7 under the symbol of a little horn. In Daniel chapter 7, so turn back with me and let's just review that for a few minutes. Daniel chapter 7. And this is really another study all unto itself, but I want to review some of this just quickly so that we have a basis for saying what we're saying for those who maybe aren't that familiar with it. In Daniel chapter 7, beginning in verse 1, it says, "In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and had three ribs in the mouth of it, between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, Arise, devour much flesh. Verse 6. After this I beheld, and lo, a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots, and behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things." There are at least 9 identifying marks about this beast power, this little horn power, which actually identifies with the beast of Revelation chapter 13, and these are listed here in Daniel chapter 7. I just want to go over some of these very quickly with you. One of the marks is, as it reads here in verse 7, it comes up among where the other horns are. Now, it's interesting that I was looking at a Baptist website last night, and a study that they had prepared on Daniel chapter 7. And there's four great beasts. There's a lion, the bear, the leopard, and then the nondescript beast. And then the little horn power. And do you know who this Baptist website identified the lion to be? Babylon. And you know who they said the bear was? Medo-Persia. And they said that the leopard beast correctly was Grecia, and the fourth beast was Rome. They had all of it down. In fact, they had the days, the years, the date for the years, just almost exactly the way we date it, very accurately. And you know what else? They had a picture of Nebuchadnezzar's dream there beside it. And they were linking it back to Daniel chapter 2. And so in Adventism, when we use these historical understandings, we're not alone. We're not oddballs in this. But the part that we do tend to separate ourselves from other people on is when we come to this little horn power. But as we see here in our first mark, it says it comes up among the 10, or where Western Europe was. It comes up after the 10. It uproots 3, never to rise again. In verse 8 here, it says he plucked up 3 of the first horns. And in verse 20, it says, "And of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, and before whom 3 fell." And then in verse 24, "And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise, and another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first, and shall subdue 3 kings." And so we know that this is also something that happened. It has a man at its head. It is a different kind of power. In verse 24, as we read, it's diverse from the others. It blasphemies. It persecutes. It thinks to change times and laws. In verse 25, it says, "And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand, into a time and times and the dividing of times." But there's one and only one power in all the world that really meets all these requirements. And we know that it's the power that we today call the Roman Catholic Church, or the papacy, the papal power. It came up among the 10 in Western Europe. It came up after the 10 became part of that Western Europe conclave. We know the Roman Empire basically disintegrated in 476 AD, and the papacy came to its political power in 538 with the decree of Justinian when it went into effect. He actually gave the decree in 533, but it was took about 5 years for the decree to go into effect because they had to eliminate certain people, and they weren't all eliminated yet. And there were three of those people that were eliminated, and they were the Urales, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. This map shows the different 10 tribes that came out of the Roman Empire that made up those 10 horns, of which a little horn came up among them. And you see the Urales were in that area near what we call today Italy, and the Vandals down in northern Africa, and the Ostrogoths over there to the northeast of Italy in that area. Well, it has a man at its head, the Pope, of course. It teaches abominable doctrines. It teaches the doctrine, for instance, of confession, where a man confesses his sins to another man. It has the doctrine of the Pope being the head of the church instead of Christ being the head of the church. And one of his titles is Vicarius Filii Dei, which means vicar of the Son of God, or he is the substitute of the Son of God for the Son of God. And it is a persecuting power. If we go to the next slide, we see a picture of Fox's Book of Martyrs. Fox's Book of Martyrs was first published in 1563, and it was actually, they said it was like two hand widths high, thick, because of all the details of the persecutions that it listed. And the persecutions mostly, in fact, were those from England, Scotland, Ireland area, but really even all the rest of Europe, and so it didn't have everything. But some of the most conservative estimates are that at least 50 million people died through the Inquisitions and the persecutions of the Catholic Church. At least 50 million. So we think of events like World War II as being one of the most traumatic events of the history of the earth, because about 50 million people died in World War II. You know, when you combine all the people who died from a disease and the Holocaust and the fighting, about 50 million people is tremendous. But at least that many, and probably many more, died during what we today call the Dark Ages through the persecutions of the papal power. And so the papacy fulfills all these. It reigns for a time, times, dividing of times. That's from 538 to 1798, 1260 days. 1260 prophetic days means 1260 literal years, the same as the 42 months that the beast power of Revelation 13 reigns. And all these different marks show up. She uprooted, we mentioned, the Urales, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. And do you know why the papacy decided it had to uproot those three powers? Why did they have to take care over those three powers?
Arian.
They were called Arian powers. Now, when we use the term Arian today, it doesn't mean the same thing as like the, quote, Arian nation, like they talk about the people who came from Germany who wanted to promote a white-only kind of society. These were people who had a belief in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, and they didn't believe in a doctrine called the Trinity. And so the Catholic Church, in order to have the political and religious clout it needed, it had to eliminate these people. It is a different kind of power than the rest, because it's not only a civil power, it's also a political and religious power combined. It changes times and laws, specifically the Ten Commandments. And we could look at several of the Ten Commandments that they've changed, but we're specifically going to look today at just mostly the Fourth Commandment. But there is a principle that the papacy, that this system works upon, and it's called tradition. And it says that the traditions of the Church are actually more important, or trump, the Bible, and that the traditions of the Church can interpret the Bible. But notice what Jesus said. Let's look at some words from Christ in John chapter 4. John chapter 4 and verse 24. Jesus is speaking to a woman, a Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. And notice what he says in verse 24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. That's emphatic, isn't it? That we must worship God in spirit and truth. But how do we know what truth is? How do we know what truth is? How can we determine what is right and what's wrong? Thy word is truth. Jesus said, thy word is truth. And this is the only way that we can know this. In Matthew chapter 15, Jesus gave a solemn warning. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 9. Jesus said, in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. So when we just have commandments or sayings or teachings of men, Jesus calls that what kind of worship? He calls it vain worship. But remember, friends, according to Revelation 13:3, almost the whole world's going to wonder after this beast's power. They're going to follow the traditions of the papacy. And Jesus gave us warning and warning and warning. In fact, in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 13, Jesus said, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth into life, and few there be that find it." Now, I told you that the largest professed Christian group today in the world is what? Roman Catholic Church, the papacy. Have over 1 billion members. Jesus is telling us that wherever the majority is, that is a sure sign it's not the place to be. It's not the place. Now, we don't have to go to the other extreme and say, well, that must mean that the smallest group is the right group. You can't, you know, that's not logic, that's sound. Jesus never said that. But it is true that he said it will be a small group. It's a little flock. In Luke chapter 12, is it verse 32, Jesus said, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." He says, "Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leads to eternal life, and few there be that find it." In Matthew chapter 7, going on down to verse 21, Jesus says, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." Now, iniquity is a synonym for sin. And Jesus says that his way is the way of truth. And Satan's way, friends, is the way of iniquity. It's the way of sin. And he says that not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will. And where is the will of God specifically delineated, especially in connection with iniquity or sin? It's in his Ten Commandments. Jesus is saying, those who do the Ten Commandments and keep my law, they're the ones who are going to enter in, not in the others. Jesus said, if you love me, to do what? Keep my commandments. Where is that found? John 14, verse 15. John chapter 14, verse 15. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. I'm going to ask you that a little bit later, Jonathan. And I want you to remember that. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And that's in John chapter 14, verse 15. If you remember 14 and 15, what's today's date? 14th. So if you remember today's date and one more day and your name, you got that text, okay? John 14, verse 15. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. I want to share with you a few statements concerning the Sabbath that the Spirit of Prophecy says about it. She says here, and this is from Early Writings, pages 32 and 33, "The Lord gave me the following view in 1847 while the brethren were assembled on the Sabbath at Topsham, Maine. In the holiest I saw an ark. On the top and sides of it was purest gold. I saw the Ten Commandments written on them with the finger of God. On one table were four, and on the other six. The four on the first table shone brighter than the other six. But the fourth, the Sabbath commandment, shone above them all. For the Sabbath was set apart to be kept in honor of God's holy name. The holy Sabbath looked glorious. A halo of glory was all around it. I saw that the Sabbath commandment was not nailed to the cross. If it was, the other nine were. And we were at liberty to break them all, as well as to break the fourth. I saw that God had not changed the Sabbath, for he never changes, but the Pope had changed it from the seventh to the first day of the week, for he was to change times and laws." And in Early Writings on page 255, "It was represented to me that the remnant followed Jesus into the most holy place and beheld the ark and the mercy seat and were captivated with their glory." Let me just pause there. Who does she say followed Jesus? The remnant. This is our experience today. By faith, we are to do this. It says, "Jesus then raised the cover of the ark, and lo, the tables of stone with the Ten Commandments written upon them. They trace down the living oracles, but start back with trembling when they see the fourth commandment among the ten holy precepts with a brighter light shining upon it than upon the other nine, and a halo of glory all around it." Now, the Bible calls the devil, in Revelation chapter 12, a dragon. He's described there as a dragon. And he is at war against God, and he's at war against God's people. And the main reason he's at war against God's people is because he hates God. And he knows that he can't fight against God. But if he can hurt God's people, he can touch the apple of God's eye. And therefore, he puts his efforts against God's people, and he fights against them. And he hates God's law. He hates God's law. And so he especially attacks the law of God among the people of God and tries to diminish the law of God or to get people, the people of God, to break the Ten Commandments of God. Now, in this testimony that we just read, in fact, in two testimonies here, we see that the Sabbath in the Ark in heaven, the Sabbath commandment in the Ark in heaven, on that table stone, it shines brighter than the other table, and specifically the Sabbath commandment shines even brighter because that is the commandment that tells us who God is. It tells us his seal, his name, his title, and his territory are all in that commandment. And this makes sense. If we go to Exodus, just to review it, Exodus chapter 20. And what verses in Exodus chapter 20 tell us about the Sabbath commandment? 8 through 11. That's right. You know, if you knew that the Ten Commandments were in Exodus 20, you did better than one preacher one time. I was at a meeting one time, and they asked this preacher where the Ten Commandments were, and he said, Leviticus 20 or something. He didn't really know. I thought, how can this man be a minister? But it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. Thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day, wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. It tells us here who did this. Who is the great creator? It is the Lord. It is God himself. It is Jehovah, or Yahweh. And it says that he has created all things in heaven and earth. There's nothing that we see, nothing that we can experience that in some way God didn't have a creative hand in. We can't just say, well, he created just simply our solar system. We go out to a certain boundary line and we find something else that somehow just came out and was there by its own existence. Not at all. You know, I find it so interesting that the evolutionists deny that God exists. But then, or at least I suppose most of them do. I should say it that way. We'll say, well, where did we come from? Well, we came from the Big Bang. Well, where did the Big Bang come from? Well, it all started with this little piece of energy about the size of a pea. Okay. Where did that piece of energy come from? Where did that whatever it was come from, you see? And we know what the Bible says. The Bible says that God has been forever and ever, and that he has brought forth everything into existence. But it says that, for in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth. And that harks back to the creation story. And so in Genesis chapter 2, if we could turn back there, we read here about the creation, and we read about the Sabbath being instituted. In Genesis chapter 2, and verses 1 through 3, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the first day of the week, and made it holy. No?
No.
That's not what it says?
No.
And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. It's interesting here that in this beginning statement, it doesn't simply even say that God blessed the Sabbath day. It says he blessed the seventh day. He didn't want any confusion later, because some people say, well, you know, the Sabbath has been moved from the seventh day to the first day, and therefore the blessing gets moved too, because it was the Sabbath. It was the concept of the Sabbath itself was blessed. But no, the Bible says it was actually the seventh day that was blessed. The seventh day that was blessed. Now, today, unfortunately, there is among those who profess to be God's people a lot of confusion about which day is the seventh day now. There's a teaching called the Lunar Sabbath that has come in among some of God's people. And they say, well, you know, the week changes and the week is variable. But this really doesn't fit in with history. It doesn't fit in with logic. It doesn't fit in with the Bible. And it doesn't fit in with the spirit of prophecy either. Ellen White tells us in Patriarchs and Prophets on page 48, in Eden, God set up the memorial of his work of creation in placing his blessing upon the seventh day. And then J.N. Andrews, writing about the history of the Sabbath, in his book, The History of the Sabbath, on page 510, states this, and this was something that was so important, Ellen White actually quotes it in the book Great Controversy on pages 437 and 438. It says, "The importance of the Sabbath as the memorial of creation is that it keeps ever present the true reason why worship is due to God. For the worship of God is based upon the fact that He is the Creator and that all other beings were created by Him. The Sabbath, therefore, lies at the very foundation of divine worship. For it teaches this great truth in the most impressive manner. And no other institution does this. The true ground of divine worship, not of that on the seventh day merely, but of all worship, is found in the distinction between the Creator and His creature. This great fact can never become obsolete and must never be forgotten." That's Jane Andrews on his book, The History of the Sabbath. And you know, you think about that and this issue of worship. If we go back to Revelation chapter 14 now, we start in Revelation 13, but let's go to Revelation 14. Because Revelation 14 is actually God's response to what the beast is doing in Revelation 13. In Revelation chapter 14, John sees three angels, as it were, flying in the midst of heaven. And we're just going to read here verses 6 and 7. "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come, and worship Him." Remember Andrew's talking about worship? Here it says, "Now worship Him. Worship Him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water." And this is actually a direct quotation from the fourth commandment, right out of the Septuagint version. And so he's saying to us that our worship involves worshiping God on the Sabbath day. And this is part of the great reform that's going to come in at the very end of time to counteract the work of the beast that's been described in chapter 13 of Revelation. Now, this power claims that they have changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. And prophecy said that they would do it. Back in Daniel 7, remember? He would think to change times and laws. Prophecy said he would do it. History says that he did it. The spirit of prophecy says that it would be done. And they themselves even admit that they would do this. This is from the Catholic Mirror of September 23, 1894. It says, "The Catholic Church for over 1,000 years before the existence of a Protestant, by virtue of her divine mission, changed the day from Saturday to Sunday." Now that's their own statement. They admit that they have done this. So inspiration says that they would do it. History says that they've done it. They admit that they've done it. Yeah, I find it so ironic and sad that many Protestants fail to admit it. They'll try to worm out around or wiggle around it. But the seventh-day Sabbath, this is the Lord's day. And Sunday, friends, Sunday is the day of the papacy. Not only that, but Sunday is the day religiously dedicated to the worship of the Trinity. Part of their false doctrine. Part of the wine of Babylon. But, you know, the Lord does have a day. In fact, in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10. John says, "I was in the Spirit on" what? "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet." So the Lord says He has a day, right? Must be Sunday. That's when everyone calls the Lord's day anymore, right? Does the Bible ever call the first day of the week, does it ever call Sunday the Lord's day? No, but God Himself says the Sabbath is my holy day. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Do you have a Bible text for it then? Because there's no Bible text that says that Sunday's a holy day. Not a single one. Where does the text say that where God says the Sabbath is my holy day? How about Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 13? He says, "If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day." In Mark chapter 2 verse 28, Jesus said He was Lord of the Sabbath day. This is His day. He is the Lord of that day. And He is the Lord of this day. It is the same seventh day since creation week has come about. In fact, in the book Patriarchs and Prophets on page 111, it says, "Like the Sabbath, the week originated at creation and it has been preserved and brought down to us through Bible history. God Himself measured off the first week as a sample for successive weeks to the close of time. Like every other, it consisted of seven literal days." 6 days were employed in the work of creation. Upon the seventh, God rested, and he then blessed this day and set it apart as a day of rest for man. In the law given from Sinai, God recognized the week and the facts upon which it is based. This concept of this lunar Sabbath, it says that the week is always changing. It's not the same each time. You know, each month has different weeks. But the spirit of inspiration tells us that this same Sabbath has come down to us through history. The same week has come down to us through history. That this weekly cycle has never changed. It has never changed. You know, the Bible tells me that Jesus kept the Sabbath. Do you believe that? Yeah, well, where is that text that says it was his custom? She says it was the custom of Jesus to keep the Sabbath. Where was that text? You know where it is, don't you? That's right. It's in Luke chapter 4 and verse 16. Let's turn to Luke 4:16. Let's read it. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for it to read. I think he did more than just attend church. I think he participated in church. Can you say amen to that? In other words, it was his custom to go there, but I think it was his custom also to read and to participate and to be a part of the service. The Apostle Paul and the Apostles, they all kept the Sabbath. And one of many examples we could look at is in Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16 and verse 13, he says, "And on the Sabbath day we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made, and we sat down and spake unto the women that resorted thither." And so Paul here, where there was not a place to meet otherwise, they went out. This is not a meeting place of the Jews. Sometimes you'll hear people use the excuse, well, the Christians only kept the Sabbath because that's where the Jews were. They were trying to reach the Jews. And many times Paul did try to reach the Jews. He would meet them where they were at, and even on the Sabbath day. But it wasn't simply because that was where he met them, but because it was still the Sabbath. Here they went by a riverside. There's no mention of anyone else, just a few Christian believers. And this is a long time after the cross, at least 20 years after the cross. And so God was showing that he was still blessing the seventh day Sabbath. Now, I want to tell you very plainly that I don't believe that God was taken by surprise by the devil's attempt to destroy God's people, to dishonor his law. Today, there's going to be a group of people who obey God, even if the whole world runs after Satan. I want to share with you a few statements from Selected Messages, Book 3. It says, "The seventh day Sabbath is in no uncertainty. It is God's memorial of his work of creation. It is set up as a heaven-given memorial to be observed as a sign of obedience. God wrote the whole law with his finger on two tables of stone." She says, "Now, my sister, I write to tell you that we are not to give the least credence to the dateline theory." Now, what Ellen White's talking about when she says the dateline theory is, you know that in the Pacific Ocean, there's an area called the International Dateline. And there were people at that time, some people, particularly in Australia, that were preaching that we had the day wrong because this dateline had got everything mixed up. And they were using this as an excuse to not keep the right Sabbath. And she says, there's no credence to this idea at all. We know what the real Sabbath is. She says, "It is a snare of Satan brought in by his own agents to confuse minds. You see how utterly impossible for this thing to be, that the world is all right observing Sunday and God's remnant people are all wrong? This theory of the dayline would make all our history for the past 55 years a complete fallacy, but we know where we stand." Selected Messages, Book 3, page 318. Friends, if this concept of the lunar Sabbath, for instance, if it was true, then that would mean that what Ellen White said here concerning those 50-some years, well, it'd be 100 plus years now, maybe 150 years. All that would be fallacy now, you see. But it's not. She says, we know where we stand. She says it is as certain that we have the truth. In 1881, she wrote, "It's as certain that we have the truth as that God lives," in Volume 4 of the Testimonies, page 595. It's just as certain that we have the testimony that God lives. And that included the seventh-day Sabbath. Now, as we reported and gave you a little bit of information in the April issue of Old Paths last year, on March the 13th of last year, House Speaker John Boehner, a representative of Ohio, extended a formal and open invitation to Pope Francis to address a joint meeting of Congress. His address as a visiting head of state before a joint meeting of the House and Senate would honor our nation in keeping with the best traditions of our democratic institutions. It would also offer an excellent opportunity for the American people as well as the nations of the world to hear his message in full. In other words, the Pope was invited to use the United States Capitol building as his pulpit. The USA Today also reported that the House Minority Leader, Nancy Pelosi, who is also a Roman Catholic and normally a bitter political enemy of Boehner, had joined Boehner in welcoming Pope Francis to address Congress. The article also reported that she stated that Pelosi attended his inauguration at the Vatican and praised him as, quote, a moral force. Last week, it was announced that the Pope had accepted the invitation to speak and would, in fact, address our Congress on September 24th of this year. Boehner, who frequently references his own Catholic faith, in fact, if you go to his official website as Speaker of the House and you click on the thing about him, it tells all about his Catholic upbringing and how important that was to him when he was in the business world and then when in the political world. It says that when he was trying to make this decision, that he went to the Catholic Church every morning to pray there about this decision, whether he should go into politics or not. Every morning, for many days, he went there to pray until he got his answer. Boehner said, "We're humbled that the Holy Father has accepted our invitation and certainly look forward to receiving his message on behalf of the American people." Friends, he doesn't accept any religious message in behalf of me for anything, and no other person does. Pelosi, and by the way, you know that Boehner is the head of the House, took the position that Pelosi used to have. And they are political bitter enemies, but they're both staunch Catholics. And so in this, they have easy common ground. It's reported that she was honored. She said that she was honored and overjoyed to learn that the Pope had accepted this invitation. She said, "Pope Francis has renewed the faith of Catholics worldwide and inspired a new generation of people, regardless of their religious affiliation, to be instruments of peace." It says that she was overjoyed about the papal visit. The Pope will make a visit with the full support of the President as well. White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest said, and I quote, "I can tell you that the President and his team here at the White House have been anticipating the visit from Pope Francis here in the United States for quite some time, and even as far back as the President's visit to the Vatican when he first met Pope Francis. He talked about how eager he was to welcome the Pope to the United States, so the President is certainly looking forward to this visit." And last week, in his National Prayer Breakfast talk, President Obama declared that he was a great admirer of the Pope. And he went on to say, "He, that is the Pope, challenges us to press on in what he calls our march of living hope. And like millions of Americans, I am very much looking forward to welcoming Pope Francis to the United States later this year." Now, when the Pope speaks at the United States Capitol to our Congress, whose leadership says that they are sitting here doing this in behalf of the American people, it will certainly constitute a repudiation of our Constitution. And we have been told in Volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 451, "When Protestantism shall stretch her hand across the gulf to grasp the hand of the Roman power, when she shall reach over the abyss to clasp hands with spiritualism, when under the influence of this threefold union, our country shall repudiate every principle of its constitution as a Protestant and Republican government and shall make provision for the promulgation of papal falsehoods and delusions, then," and by the way, if Boehner is opening the Capitol to this man to teach us what he believes, isn't that promulgating Catholic belief to us? Of course it is. It says, "Then we may know that the time has come for the marvelous working of Satan and that the end is near." In other words, friends, this is no red herring. This is the real deal.
Is this the first time
the Pope has never addressed our government ever before? It's interesting that this is just the time for the marvelous working of Satan, and he is going to work especially within the professed people of God. Notice what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 24. He says, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall shew great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect." In Mark 13, verse 22, I believe it is, in the parallel passage, it says, "Seduce the elect." They'll deceive. They will seduce the elect. You know, when you get seduced, you don't think you're getting something bad. You think you're getting something good. But you're tricked into taking something that's bad, something that's wrong. I find it very, very ironic in its timing that this last week also was the very first week that the first Seventh-day Adventist Church in Huntsville, Alabama, called its surge. Last Sunday, they started their very first Sunday keeping meeting. And they advertised it as the very first thing you see on their website, this picture that we have here. It's called Surge. And it's no suits, no ties, just Jesus, they say. And so this is an emphasis on a laid-back, social kind of gospel, a happy, fun gospel. And it's interesting, their logo for First Church and the way they spell out First Seventh-day Adventist Church, it's First Church is what's emphasized. The Seventh-day Adventist is not what's emphasized. It's First Church is emphasized. And you know, we see this done in other denominations, the First Baptist Church, First Methodist Church, you know, the First Presbyterian Church, Second Presbyterian Church, Third Presbyterian Church. If it's a big city, they might have several, and they name them that way sometimes, you know. But Jesus said that this kind of a spirit is wrong, friends. We're all brothers. There's no one who's the First Church. This is an egotistic kind of way of dealing with that we're bigger, we're first, we're better. And the logo, by the way, it almost looks like a yin-yang sign, but I don't think it was probably designed like that on purpose, but it just happens to look a lot like one. But I want to tell you, what they're doing is not a lone wolf among the denominations. There are many churches that are having, every year in the spring, are having annual sunrise services on Sunday, and now more and more are starting to have these kind of Sunday services. But it's interesting, and I was going to show you some examples of something. I don't think I'm going to do this. But this church, like so many churches, celebrates in its service. And I'm just going to flip by a couple slides, but we're going to make a recording of this, and you can see it in the recording later. But I've just not felt today the liberty to play this in a holy meeting on the Sabbath with you. But you'll be able, you can go to their website. They don't hide this at all. And you can look through their archives of video sermons. And you will see jive talking, romantic music like you would hear at a dinner club or a nightclub. You would hear this kind of music, people singing to it. Then you'll see the rocking and the rolling and the jive and the band and all that. And we're not going to go with that today, but it will be in the video if you want to see the recording. Just a small amount, just to give you an idea. I hate to promulgate that kind of thing. In the second video clip that was in the slides, there was a group of young adults, young people, and they were into this hip-hop kind of music in the church. And I found this so ironic because as Brother Mike and I, we were traveling down to a funeral this last week, we were listening to a presentation by Dr. Frank Garlock, who was a musicologist, used to be at Bob Jones University, and he's retired now. But in this, he was talking about the appropriateness, or actually the inappropriateness, of using rock and roll music in a worship service. And he told us some of the results of a survey that I thought was quite interesting. He says, even among the people, the young people who like this, most of them will tell you that it's not appropriate for worship. It's not appropriate to be used in a sacred service. But what they did was they actually surveyed Christian and non-Christian people. And more non-Christian people said it was inappropriate for a worship service than the professed Christians. And so then when I see these churches have these large groups of young people, and they're using this music in worship, when the majority of even the people who believe in it say it's not good for worship, you know that it's getting pretty bad. You know it's fallen quite far. But I want to tell you a little bit about the Holy Flesh movement and how this connects in. As it says, you see here on the slide, there's a picture of the state of Indiana in 1901, there was a movement called the Holy Flesh Movement among Seventh-day Adventists in this area. And this movement taught that if you went through a certain experience, that you would receive what was called holy flesh. You wouldn't die. You'd be translated. Jesus was coming soon. You're going to be translated. And that you would never sin again. And Ellen White, writing about this, in one point she said there's not a thread of truth in the entire fabric of this movement. But part of this movement involved loud worship. Worship that we would today call celebration worship. It was basically like what we today call celebration worship. They would have drums, they would be dancing and clapping and shouting and loud instruments, just like what I could have shown you is taking place at the first church in Huntsville and in other churches as well, many other churches. Now remember, we read the statement from Volume 5 of the Testimonies that said that when we come up to this point where Catholic doctrine is being promulgated through our legislative means, you know, through our governments and stuff, then we know it's time for the marvelous working of Satan, right? We're at the end. Well, I want you to notice what else she says, and this is in the book Last Day Events. Elder Stephen Haskell was sent to Indiana. He was a very trusted worker, by the way. And he was sent to Indiana to investigate this, and he wrote back to Ellen White telling her about the bedlam and the things that were happening there. And here's what she said. These things you have described as taking place in Indiana, the Lord has shown me would take place just before the close of probation. Every uncouth thing will be demonstrated. There will be shouting with drums and music and dancing. The senses of rational beings will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. And I have a footnote there that you can see more about this in Select Messages, Book 2, pages 31 through 39, where it talks about it there. But here we have these two statements now, and we have these events occurring at the same time now. We see this push for this celebration kind of worship. We see this push for Sunday worship at the very same time that the Pope is going to be coming to America, and everybody's getting ready and looking for him. And we're told that when these things happen, the marvelous working of Satan is near, and the close of probation is at hand, friends. It is time. Brethren, we know that we are at the time. The question is, what are we going to do about it? Are we going to sit back in our rocking chair and say, Lord, save the perishing? Or are we going to sound the trumpet? Will we be quiet, or will we speak? Will we share literature? Will we give Bible studies? Friends, we need to do whatever we can do right now, but I want to say one but. But, most of all, are we going to demonstrate the character of Jesus Christ? Because if people are turned off by us, yes, we must tell the people. We must somehow warn them. But you know, I maybe have warned my neighbor 20 times already, and I can keep coming and hitting and hitting and hitting him, and he's going to get turned off and off and off. And if he can't receive me, he's not going to receive my message, friends. What he needs to see first and foremost is the character of Christ, the love of Christ in my heart. If we turn off people, if they're turned off by us, they will certainly be turned off by our faith and not want anything to do with our brand of Christianity that has made us what we are. Above all things, we know that there's a doctrine called the doctrine of the love of God. In John 3:16, it tells us that God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son for us. Jesus said in John 13:35, by this shall all men know you are my disciples, if you have what? Love one to another. We must love people above all things, even if they don't agree with us. You know, do I hate John Boehner for inviting the Pope here? Of course not. I love that man. And he may be very sincere. He may be, well, I mean, you know, Jesus said many of them will do these things thinking they're doing God's service. He's not saying they're not sincere, but they're wrong. But as the case of the Apostle Paul plainly demonstrates, sincerity is not enough, friends. Sincerity is not enough. The time of ignorance should be past. And we today, above all people, should be children of light. Do you want to give the Elijah message? I do. Do you want to do the work of an Elijah? I do. The only way we can do it, friends, is if we have the character of Elijah. We have to have the character of Elijah. We have to know our God. And the Bible says in Daniel chapter 11, let's just turn there. But in verse 32, it says, speaking about one of these kings, it says, he shall do wickedly against the covenant, shall he corrupt by flatteries, but the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. There's going to be a group of people at the end time who know God, and they're going to be strong and do exploits. And it can be us. We can be a part of that group. We can be a part of those who are called and chosen and faithful. We can be a part of those who sound the trumpet and give the loud cry, but only if we have the character of Elijah, which is the character of Christ, in our lives first and foremost.